Welcome to Tarantula Collective. My name is Richard, and if you enjoy these species-specific care and husbandry videos, then make sure you're subscribed and hit that notification bell so you'll be alerted anytime I upload a new video in the future. Now today we're going to be covering another dwarf tarantula. This is one of my all-time favorite species. Now even though I'm focusing just on this one species, this husbandry information pretty much applies to the entire genus. I'm sure in time I'll get around to doing videos on each specific species, but in the meantime this should help you out no matter what species you've got. The Cyriocosmus elegans, known also as the Trinidad Dwarf Tarantula, is a New World terrestrial tarantula that comes from the tropical climates of Trinidad, Tobago, and Venezuela. With warm temperatures between 78 to 92 degrees Fahrenheit and average humidity levels around 85%, this tarantula lives in a veritable paradise. Being a dwarf tarantula, females of this species will only grow to about 1.5 to 2 inches at most, with males only getting about half that size. Like most New Worlds, they do have urticating hairs and are venomous, though their venom is not known to be medically significant, and the bite would probably be more painful than the venom, though science is still researching the effects of tarantula venom on humans. They're also researching possible medicinal properties that they have, so the science is still out, and it's best to avoid being bit by a tarantula in any case. Also, due to being such a small tarantula, females have an average lifespan of around 7 years, while males tend to only live about 2 years. These teas start out extremely tiny as slings, but are fast growers and reach their adult size within a year or two. This species is so popular because of the heart-shaped pattern on its abdomen that make it truly unique and recognizable. It also has a beautiful black triangle on its carapace, reminiscent of the Brachypelma emilia. This tarantula is docile, though a little skittish. Mine spends a lot of time walking around its enclosure, exploring and moving dirt to build tunnels, as well as doing a lot of webbing. I have seen old care sheets online suggesting you keep this tea anywhere from fossorially to arboreally, but I choose the middle path on their husbandry. I give mine plenty of substrate to burrow into, as well as providing some branches or leaves for them to anchor their webs on. I find this setup seems to make them the most comfortable. My C. elegans will burrow down in the hide and make tunnels that have 2 or 3 entrances so they can pop out in different areas of their enclosure. And they web up extensively around those openings and even make little web tunnels above the ground. Having plenty of places to quickly retreat to safely seems to give them the confidence to spend a lot of time out in the open, where they can be easily observed. Usually, when I go to open their enclosure, they will quickly dash into hiding, as they prefer flight over fight. I have never seen my Cyriocosmus give me any threat pose, and even though they are New World tarantulas with urticating hairs, mine have never kicked any at me. But even after running for cover in their burrow, they almost always immediately turn around and poke their front legs out to see what's going on. They are inquisitive little explorers, though cautiously curious. Now I keep my spiderlings in a small dram vial filled about 2/3 the way with substrate and place in some sphagnum moss for them to use as a hide and do some webbing. Like with most of my spiderlings, I keep the substrate damp but not soggy and drip water down the side of the enclosure and on the sphagnum moss at least once a week to keep the humidity up. I try to always drip the water on one side and let it soak into the bottom, sometimes poking the dirt with a long skinny stick to help saturate the bottom layer of substrate without flooding the burrow and top layer. Because these spiderlings are so small, you must be mindful about the size of the ventilation holes you use, as they can easily escape through the tiniest holes. To avoid this issue, I use a thumbtack and poke holes in the lid of the dram vial to provide a little ventilation without risking an escape. You also need to be careful anytime that you're opening the enclosure, as sometimes these tiny slings will crawl up the sides of their enclosure and be on the lid or in the corner of the lid. When you open it up, they may wander off without you even noticing. Once they reach about half an inch, or appear to be outgrowing their dram vial, I move them into a basic spiderling enclosure. Again, I fill up the enclosure about two-thirds with substrate and provide a hide and small water dish. I keep the substrate a little damp, again saturating the bottom level while avoiding flooding the burrows and keeping the top layer a little dry. I also add in little branches, leaves, or small fake plants for the tea to use as anchor points for their webbing should they choose. About once every week or two, I'll drip some water on the sphagnum moss to help keep the humidity up a little higher than normal. But that probably isn't so much a necessity as it is just my method. Up to this size, I keep them in my climate-controlled spiderling nursery, which remains at a constant 78 degrees Fahrenheit. I also keep a water dish in the nursery to help raise the humidity to a little higher than the ambient humidity of the room. But as I keep mine in the basement, dry conditions are not really an issue that I deal with. When they are approaching their adult size and have grown over an inch, I move them into an acrylic juvenile enclosure. At most, this tea really only needs an enclosure around 6 inches cubed, but I keep them right now in an enclosure that measures 4x4x5. A general rule is to keep them in an enclosure 3 times their leg span. So if mine get any larger, I will move them into my larger juvenile enclosures around 6 to 8 inches cubed. I fill the enclosure between half to two-thirds full of substrate, and again provide a hide, water dish, sphagnum moss, and a fake plant or two. I still pour water down a corner of the enclosure to keep the bottom layer damp while keeping the top layer dry. This gives the tea the ability to burrow down when they prefer more humid conditions, and stay out on top when they want more drier ones. At this size, I see my Cyriocosmus utilize both burrowing and webbing, alternating between being underground and climbing around like a semi-arboreal tarantula. Their fine silk webs only add to the beauty of this tarantula, and it's why I find mine to be an awesome display tarantula. Even though they are so small, they do not disappoint when it comes time to feed. They quickly take down their prey in a dramatic fashion and rarely refuse a meal unless they're in pre-molt. When it comes time to feed, I give my spiderlings small flightless fruit flies or flower beetles about twice a week. If they are nearing a molt or seem disinterested in eating, I will cut back to feeding once a week, but that is rarely an issue. I wait about 48 hours after a spiderling's molt before attempting to feed them again. This gives them a few days to harden up. Even as slings, they have a voracious feeding response and quickly take down their prey. Be careful not to attempt to give them any prey that is larger than they are. You can also pre-kill a cricket or roach and pull off their legs and drop one in for the sling to eat. They will scavenge feed at this size, but be sure to check back on them 24 hours later and remove any uneaten prey to avoid it molding or attracting mites. For juveniles over half an inch, I will begin feeding them 1 or 2 pinheads or very small crickets once a week. I make sure not to drop in any prey larger than the tarantula, and usually try to keep the prey around half to two-thirds the size of the tea. If I don't have any prey that small, I will smash the head of a cricket that I'm dropping in there, so it is still twitching and moving a little bit, but doesn't run the risk of the prey biting and possibly hurting the tarantula. Again, I check back up on them the next day and remove any uneaten prey, and never leave any live feeders in an enclosure if the tarantula is in pre-molt. What this tarantula lacks in size, it certainly makes up for in its appearance and personality. A lot of people disregard dwarf species because they're so small, opting for the big hairy tarantulas, which is understandable. But it would be a mistake to overlook these tiny beauties. With their velvety appearance, that adorable heart pattern on their abdomen, the insane feeding response, and the general curiosity and gentleness of this tea makes it one of my favorite genus of tarantula. I don't normally handle my teas, but occasionally when feeding or rehousing, my C. elegans will calmly wander out of its enclosure and onto my hand, and I'm always amazed at how brave such a small tea can be sometimes. I don't recommend holding your tarantulas, and when this small, it can be even more dangerous, as a fall from your hand to the ground could prove fatal. I always make sure that if I'm handling my tarantula, I'm doing so over a table or I am sitting down on the ground, so any accidental fall will not be lethal. Overall, their husbandry is very straightforward and like most all New World terrestrial teas. Just provide adequate ventilation, a water dish while keeping them at room temperature, and avoid misting their enclosure. Now for the most part, the husbandry for this species is pretty straightforward. You keep it just like you would pretty much any other New World tarantula. Just provide it a hide, a water dish, some substrate. Now if you're giving them adequate ventilation and you're staying away from your heat pads and the heat lamps and things of that nature, you're gonna be all right. Now one of the best things about dwarf tarantulas is you can keep multiple adult specimens that take up a fraction of the space as some of the other larger species. And this is perfect for people that have large collections like me, or even those with smaller collections that just have a limited amount of space. You're gonna be hard pressed to find a tarantula that is more cute than these guys. Especially with that heart on its abdomen, even the biggest arachnophobe's heart is gonna melt a little bit when they look at that. Now this weekend, I'm gonna be at the North American Reptile Breeders Conference, the NARBC. I'll be hanging out there with Fear Not Tarantulas and some of the moderators from the Facebook group. It's just a couple days away, but if you're planning on being there, keep your eye out for me. Come up, say hello, introduce yourself. I'd love to meet you. Now it's gonna take me a little while to edit it all together, but once I get back, I'm gonna put together a video and let you all see exactly what was going on there. Now for all things related to the Tarantula Collective, from social media to merchandise, check out my website, thetarantulacollective.com. There you'll find links to the Patreon, Facebook, Instagram, pretty much anywhere we are is linked up right there on the website. We've also got some cool cell phone cases, t-shirts, hats, all that stuff as well. Now if you enjoyed this video, be sure you hit that like button. It helps future keepers find this information further on down the road. And if you wanna support the channel, go ahead and subscribe and share this video. Now if there's a species you would like to see me cover in future episodes of Tarantula Tuesday, be sure to leave that suggestion down below in the comments. Your all suggestions really help me out a lot. In fact, this was a video a lot of you all were suggesting to me, so I'm glad I was able to cover this one for you. Now if you want to check out some videos from the last time I went to NARBC, just tap or click right here. And if you want to catch up on all the past Tarantula Tuesday videos, just tap or click right there. Well, thank you all for watching. I appreciate your support, and I will see you next Tuesday.
That's a bet, right? That's a deal, right? That's a deal.